the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble he will hide me in his pavilion. In the secret place of his tabernacle he will hide me. He will set me high upon a rock. And verse 13 says, I would have fainted unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart.
Thank you.
Wait, I say, on the Lord. Let us pray. Consecrate us now to thine service, God, by the power of thy grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope. Let my will be lost in yours. God, we pray that something that is said in these next few moments will be what somebody needs to
bless
hear.
Her, Lord.
So God, move like only you can. Allow your strength to be made perfect even in my weakness, God. Move, Lord God, as you see fit. And know that whatever you decide to do this afternoon, it'll be all right with us. And we'll be so careful to give your name the praise, to give your name the honor, and to give your name the glory. Let the people of God say amen.
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 Amen. I try not to impose so much of my southern rural proclivities.
We love them.
On you guys, but there's a song we used to sing back home that don't have no music out, so don't worry. But it goes, I said, oh, Lord, hey. Oh, Lord, hey. Oh, my good Lord. Oh, Lord.
Come on.
Just wanna feel your hand in mine.
Come on.
I said, oh Lord, eh? Oh Lord, eh? Oh my good Lord, eh? Oh Lord,
thank God.
I just wanna feel your hand in mine.
Got a little Mahalia going.
Well, it's an uphill journey, it's an uphill journey. I don't mind, oh, but I don't mind, just as long as I can feel your hand in mine. I have to bear hard crosses, I have to bear hard crosses, but I don't mind, oh, but I
sing
don't
it.
Mind, just as long as I can feel your hand in mine. I said, oh Lordy, oh Lordy, oh my good Lord, oh Lord, I just wanna feel your holding on to hope. This song David wrote when he was in trouble, yet he starts it off in praise. He says, the Lord is my light and my salvation.
Uh-huh.
Of whom shall I fear? If an army encamps against me, my heart won't fail. If war rises against me, I'm going to trust in this. I've asked for one thing, and that one thing I'm seeking after. I want to live in the Lord's house all the days of my life, to see God's beauty and to adore God's temple. Isn't it funny? Here David's enemies are chasing him down. Here David has people who are seeking after his life and trying to kill him. And instead of starting off talking about what's happening to him, David talks about where he wants to be. David says, yes, my enemies are seeking after me, but God, I'm seeking after you. David asked the Lord for one thing, and that was to dwell in the Lord's house. David does not ask first for rescue. David does not ask first for deliverance. But David asks not that God saves him from what he's running from. David simply wants somewhere to run to. David said, if war comes up against me, I'm going to be confident because I asked God for something. I have my affection set on something. I have my mind fixed on something. David said, if war comes up against me, I'm going to be confident because I asked God for one thing. David teaches us that coping with the pain of life is not just about learning what to run from, but it's about having something to run to. Sometimes in moments of pain and crisis, we can consume ourselves with what's right before our eyes. And all of our prayers can become, God, get me out of this. God, take me away from this.
Yes.
God, rescue me from this. But you won't survive pain if you don't have something you're seeking after. I will never forget sitting on a couch and getting some couch ministry, as I like to call it. And at the end of about 3 or 4 sessions, all the therapist did was look at me and said, Racquel, you have sufficiently told me what you're living with.
Come on.
Now I need you to spend a few minutes telling me what you're living for. And to cope with life, you can't be consumed all the time with what you're dealing with, but you must have something to live for. You got to have something you're seeking after. You must have something that motivates you to get up in the morning and something that motivates you to go back home at night. You can't just consume your mind with the things that you're trying to run from, but you must have something you're running to. And I ask you this morning, not just what are you living with, but I ask you, what are you living for? What keeps you going? What keeps you moving? What allows you to push even when you feel like you have no more push in you? What allows you to go even when you feel you have no more go in you? I know what you're dealing with, but beloved, you can't survive what you're dealing with until you have something to live for. And what is David seeking? What is he living for? David said, all I'm seeking is to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. All I want to do is behold the beauty of the Lord and inquire in God's temple. In his time of trouble, in his time of darkness, in his time of pain, David needed sanctuary. David needed somewhere that he could go and feel safe. And some commentary would tell us not to take this too literal. When David really meant was that he wanted to be in God's presence all the days of his life, because nobody can really be in God's house all the days of his life. Even the priests didn't sleep in God's house, but even they had lives outside of the temple. Even the priests had to have an existence outside of the temple. So David could not have meant, I want to dwell in God's house all the days of my life. But I thought about it, and I'm not so sure. I think David could have been talking about God's presence and God's house.
All right.
Because we know that during times of war, people would hide in the temple. We know that in biblical times, when people were threatened by kings and principalities, they would make their way to the temple, and there they would feel sheltered from all the trouble that they were encountering. This is why it was so significant when the temple was destroyed, because the people had nowhere that they could feel safe. Perhaps this is why in the next verse, David says, "He will hide me in his shelter yes. in the day of trouble." The temple was a place of worship, but it was also a place of refuge. It was sanctuary. The most vulnerable, those who were hurting, those who were in pain, and those who were in sorrow could journey to the temple, could journey to the sanctuary, and there they would find refuge. And some of us today can bear witness to this fact. There have been moments in our lives when everything was crashing in on us. There have been times in our lives where we felt overwhelmed. There have been moments in our lives where we felt like giving up. But then we made our way to the sanctuary. We made our way to the temple. And when we got to the house of God, we were able to get what we needed. When we got to the temple, God sent us a community of people to help us in time of trouble. There's something about being in the house of God that makes people feel safe. There's something about being in the house of God that makes people feel better. There's something about being in the house of God that makes people feel protected. David said, "All I wanted to do was get to God's house, because I knew if I could get to God's house, I would feel safe." Yeah, yeah. But I wrestled with this. I did. Because the reality for many people today is that they make their way to God's house and they get just as hurt in God's house
uh-huh.
as they did outside of God's house. Thomas Rainer says that most people leave church. Church retention is most present after a funeral. Usually something that was said or done to someone in a moment of grief makes them distrustful of the church.
Mm-hmm.
And I know we say we are imperfect people serving a perfect God. I know that getting hurt in church is inevitable because we're all human. But at some point we have to grapple with the fact that many of our Christian institutions have hurt just as many people as they have helped. We have to grapple with the fact that there are many people who would rather sit at home and deal with their pain on their own than to enter into these doors and encounter shallow theology that does not speak to the reality of their hurt, but glosses over it and says anything just to get a few cheap amens. And I'm not just exaggerating, because I've talked to person after person after person who has told me, "I'll go back to church after I get better, because church folk can say stuff that sometimes make me feel worse." I've seen people who couldn't go back to church after the hate-filled eulogy yes. that was preached after their mother committed suicide. I've seen people who couldn't go back to church because they went to get prayer for their depression and the deacon called their depression a demon and tried to cast it out. I've seen people who couldn't go back to church because a year after they had to bury their twin babies, the church mother asked them why they were still so sad, as if grief has an expiration date. I've seen people who couldn't go back to church because they were told that mental illness is a white folks disease. I've seen people who couldn't go back to church because as soon as the preacher saw them walk through the doors, all of a sudden the sermon about grace turned into a sermon about their sexuality. I've seen people who couldn't go back to church because the same people who abused them and didn't apologize are now serving the communion. And I know we put the blame on them and say you shouldn't let people keep you out of God's house. But at some point we gotta hold ourselves accountable and do better.
Woo!
People are supposed to come here and be healed. But instead, we've become the source of their trauma and the source of their pain. And if we are not a healing station, then we are just a group of people who come here on Sunday and run up the light bill. But God, make your house a house of prayer and a place of healing for everybody who comes. But this is not everybody's testimony.
Yes, my Lord.
Everybody has not been able to come through these doors and find sanctuary. Everybody has not been able to come to church and be okay. And for as much as the blame is on them, the blame is also on us. But we realize in Psalm 27 that coping is not about escaping emotions, but facing emotions. In Psalm 27, David goes through the full range of his human emotion. We see him making a proclamation of praise to praying for God's deliverance. David grapples with his praise, but he also acknowledges the reality of his hurt. Verse 1 through 6 is David praising God. David is remembering that God is the God of his salvation. David is remembering that God is his light. David is remembering that he does not have to be afraid of anything. David is remembering that there is a place that he can go and be sheltered during troubling times. But then in verse 7 through 12, David becomes uncertain. David becomes unsure. David is crying out to God for help. David is saying, God, hear me when I call you. God, don't hide your face from me. God, don't neglect me and leave me alone. And then in verse 13 and 14, he makes his way to hope. I believe that I will see God's goodness while I'm alive. Before David can get to hope, he must build his confidence in praise, but he must root his confidence in the reality of his situation. David cannot escape his trouble. David cannot pretend that his trouble is not there, but he holds on to the confidence that God will save him from his trouble. David goes through all of the extremes of human emotion before he can move into the hope of God's goodness. And there is a lesson for us, because many a times we are made to feel as though hope and pain cannot reside in the same body. So many times we are made to feel that you can't be honest about the reality of your suffering and you can't be real about the trouble you're in, because to do so is to give up hope. But life is a delicate balance of your praise and your lament. The truth, beloved, is that your life can not only be praise.
That's right.
No, you don't like to hear that. Because your Bible says, I will bless the Lord at all times. But there are some days when you can't muster up a hallelujah anyhow. There are some days when you can't give God a shout for joy. There are some moments where you just can't build up the wherewithal to lift your hands. And that does not make you sinful. That does not make you faithless. But beloved, that makes you human.
Uh-huh.
Life that only sits in praise is false hope and naivete. It is hope that ignores the reality of life, and it does not teach you how to cope with your pain, but it pushes you to ignore your pain. And just as life cannot be all praise, life cannot be all lament. Your life cannot always be consumed with the reality of your suffering. Your mind cannot always be overwhelmed with the reality of your trouble. But you have to have moments where your head is higher than your enemies. You have to have moments where God hides you in the secret place and you realize that your troubles are real, but so is your God. Life is not all about praise. Life is not all about sorrow, but life is the balance of your praise and your sorrow. Life is the balance of past me not, oh gentle Savior, and I will bless the Lord at all times. Life is the balance of I will lift my hands in the sanctuary, and the balance of Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know. Life is about being real where you are, but also being about being real where you worship. Life is about being able to own your trouble, but recognizing that it will not be the end. And then when you're able to grapple with your lament, but have confidence in your praise, that is when you move to experience God's hope. So that the hope is not false, so that the hope is not naive, but the hope is grounded in where you are. After David builds his confidence in praise and roots his confidence in lament, then he is able to experience his confidence in hope. David says, I believe that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. That's what some translations say. But actually, in this text, the King James Version gets closest to the Hebrew translation. The King James Version says, "I would have fainted had I not believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living." And we don't like to deal with that "I would have fainted" part. The psalmist did not just say, "I believe I'm going to see the goodness of the Lord while I'm alive." But the psalmist said that if I didn't believe this, I would be no longer living.
All right.
The psalmist says, "Without hope, I would have died prematurely." The psalmist assures us that not only can you have hope while you cope, but you need hope to cope. Hope is a necessity in life. And sometimes hope is used so much that we have made it devoid of its meaning. We just say the word hope so loosely and so freely. But you don't know how important hope is until you visit someone who does not have it. Literally, friends, that is what depression is. It is an inability to construct hope inside of yourself. It is an inability to envision a tomorrow because you are so overwhelmed with your yesterday and so consumed with your today. And you don't know how powerful hope is until you have to visit some places where hope has disappeared. And if I've learned nothing else this year, I've learned that hopelessness is not just sad to see, but hopelessness is deadly to experience. People literally die because they could not keep their hope alive. This is why hope is not tertiary. Hope is not auxiliary. Hope is not secondary. Hope is not on the sidelines of our faith, but hope is the inseparable companion of our faith. Hope is when your faith gets wings and it has the nerve to expand. Hope is faith with some audacity. Faith believes it, but hope has the nerve to expect what your faith believes. Faith says, "I believe that God can do it." Yeah. Hope says, "I believe that God can do it for me." David says, "I believe that I will see the goodness of the Lord." David didn't just say, "I believe God is good." God is good. That's faith. But David says, "I believe not only that God is good, but I believe that in this life, God will be good to me." Faith says, "I believe it." But hope says, "I believe I will see it." And I didn't too much care for a lot of comics. I'm done. I know we're out of time. But one superhero that I'm fascinated by is Spider-Man. I fell in love with him even more when I moved to Forest Hills because I remember that's where Spider-Man went to school. That's where he lived. And I like the people who wrote Spider-Man because they made him so human. Spider-Man has to help his widowed aunt pay the bills. Spider-Man gets bullied and has to deal with rejection. Spider-Man has to deal with the death of his parents while he is known as Peter Parker.
Yeah.
Spider-Man falls in love with a few women, and most people say that Mary Jane was the love of his life. She was his main love interest, but a lot of people forget about Gwen Stacy.
All right.
And I would argue that if Mary Jane was Peter Parker's greatest love, then Gwen Stacy was the love that affected him the most. You see, when Gwen Stacy died, it took Peter a minute to cope with Gwen's death. It took Peter a minute to pull himself together and be Spider-Man again. Gwen had been kidnapped by one of Spider-Man's nemesis, and Spider-Man was able to rescue her. He catches her with his web while she's hanging on the bridge. He pulls her up with his web, thinking he has saved her life, but it's not until she gets close to him that he realizes that the whiplash from his web is what has cracked her neck. And just as he thinks he's pulling Gwen up to safety, he realizes that Gwen is already dead. And the web that he used to save the world has just killed the woman that he loves. And Peter Parker grieves, and Peter Parker is hurting. But while he's grieving, he remembered Gwen's speech. Gwen told him before she died, "No matter how dark it gets, no matter how barren it gets, promise me, Peter, that you will hold on to your hope. Keep hope alive, because you gotta be greater than what you suffer." Gwen reminded us that sometimes I don't care how great you are, I don't care how much power you have, I don't care how amazing other people see, heroes can sometimes feel hopeless, but in the moments where you want to give up, you need a Gwen Stacy in your life. You need to remind you, somebody to remind you that life can go on. You need somebody to remind you to hold on to your hope. You need somebody to remind you that you're greater than what you suffer. You're greater than what you're going through. You're greater than what you face. And I just want to let somebody know that when you go through the storms of life, when you find yourself overwhelmed, when you find yourself outdone, when you find yourself disappointed, you might not be able to hold on to your money. You might not be able to hold on to your happiness. You might not be able to hold on to your job. You might not be able to hold on to your relationships. But no matter what happens, you must hold on to your hope. I can let a lot of things slide. I can let a lot of things go. But I'm defensive about my hope. I'm territorial about my hope. I don't just put my hope in anything. I don't just tell anybody about my hopes. I don't just put my hope in everything. Because if you take away my hope, you can take away my life. You can survive a few days without water. You can make it a few days without food. You can go seconds without air. But you can't make it a single minute if you don't have hope. Woo! Hold on to hope.
Yes.
Been reading, and I'm finished. Ernest Bloch, Marxist philosopher, wrote a text entitled Disappointed Hope. What does it mean when hope has to survive disappointment? And he proposes that no matter what we face, there is something mechanically inside of the human spirit that will resolve to see another day. And when that resolve is gone, your disappointment has turned into despair. Despair means that hope has left the building and turned the corner. But disappointment means hope hasn't been fulfilled yet. And you need to remember in those moments that you want to give up, that it's all right to face disappointment, because your hope can survive disappointment, but your hope cannot survive despair. Don't give up your hope. Don't give up the reality that things can change and that things can be different. Hope can survive disappointment, but hold on to it, because it will not perish. And if it perishes, it has become despair. Let us stand.